I can see. Anyhow, once again, and I'll hand it over to Professor Balram Shukla. I had some reflections. I had a lot of ideas yesterday, but I'm going to spare you of my words now, and I may reserve them for the valedictory session, you know. But I've been thinking about the poetics and politics of rivers. I've been thinking about the metaphysics and the ecology of rivers. And finally, so three dyads. And finally, I've been thinking of rivers as metaphor and method, both. So this is what yesterday I've been thinking after our conversation. But I'm going to keep quiet. I request Dr. Balram Shukla. Balram ji, please, aap iska sanchalan karenge kripa karke.
गंगे च यमुने चैव गोदावरी सरस्वती नर्मदे सिंधु कावेरी जलेस्मिन् सन्निधिं कुरु या स्थलेस्मिन् सन्निधिं कुरु। सम्माननीय निदेशक महोदय तथा उपस्थित सभी विद्वान, भारत की साहित्यिक परंपराओं में नदियां इस विषय पर जो हम संगोष्ठी कर रहे हैं उसका उसके दूसरे सत्र में, द्वितीय दिवस के सत्र में आप सभी लोगों का स्वागत है। नदियां हमारे साहित्य में किस तरह से प्रतिबिंबित हुई हैं इसके विषय में कल बहुत अच्छे अच्छे पत्र प्रस्तुत किए गए, उस पर चर्चाएं हुई। स्वयं निदेशक महोदय ने बहुत महत्वपूर्ण बातें कही। हम देखते हैं कि वैदिक काल से ही, वेदों से ही नदियों की प्रशंसा, नदियों के लिए स्तोम यानी स्तुतियों के समूह ऋषियों ने गाए हैं, नदियों से बातें की हैं उन्होंने। और हमारी जो परंपरा है, सभ्यता है, उसका केवल सांस्कृतिक विकास ही नहीं, बौद्धिक विकास, सभ्यतिक विकास भी नदियों के किनारे हुआ है। ऋग्वेद में एक मंत्र है, उपवरे गिरीणाम संगते च नदीनां क्रिया विप्रो अजायत। जो भारत में बौद्धिकता का विकास हुआ है वो गिरियों के अर्थात पहाड़ों के उपवर में, गह्वर में और नदियों के संगम में, नदियों के साथ साथ विकसित हुई है। तो केवल तमद्दुन ही नहीं, सिविलाइजेशन ही नहीं, तहजीब भी हमारी जो है, हमारी संस्कृति और बौद्धिकता भी नदियों के नाते ही विकसित हुई है। और इसी कारण हमारे साहित्य में उसके साथ आत्मीयतापूर्ण संबंध दिखाई पड़ते हैं। कहीं नदियां माता के रूप में आती हैं, अधिकतर माता के रूप में आती हैं, कहीं बहन के रूप में भी आती हैं। नदियों को आपने माता के रूप में तो बहुत बार देखा होगा। अब महाराष्ट्र में वारकरी संप्रदाय है, वो चंद्रभागा नदी को माजी बहिणी चंद्रभागा कहता है, और वो विशेष कारण है क्योंकि वो पंढरी को माहेर यानी मातृगृह कहता है। इसके अलावा पुत्री के रूप में भी नदियों को देखा गया है। राजस्थान के एक बहुत प्रसिद्ध संस्कृत कवि माघ जो थे, भीनमाल के, उन्होंने अपशंक मंक परिवर्तनोचिता बहुत सुंदर उन्होंने बताया किस तरह से नदियां पहाड़ रूपी पिता के यहाँ से रोती हुई, कलकल करती हुई पति सागर से मिलते हुए मिलने के लिए जाती हैं। ये आत्मीयतापूर्ण संबंध बाद में देवीकृत भी हुआ, डेविफिकेशन भी हुआ उसका। आज इस पर बहुत महत्वपूर्ण पेपर भी है, रिडेम्पशन नैरेटिव्स एंड एपोथियोसिस ऑफ रिवर्स। तो हम देखेंगे कि किस तरह से सरस्वती जो कि नदी है वो उसकी गतिशीलता हमारी बुद्धि की भी गतिशीलता है। महोवर्ण सरस्वती प्रचेतयति केतुना धिया विश्वो विराजति, वो किस प्रकार बुद्धि की देवी बन जाती है। और इसी तरह से गंगा यमुना इत्यादि लौकिक संस्कृत में हम देखें तो हमें पता चलता है कि किस तरह से हमारे स्तोत्र साहित्य गंगा के, नर्मदा के, छोटी से छोटी नदियों के की प्रशंसाओं से भरे हुए हैं। लेकिन जब हम साहित्य में आते हैं तो साहित्य में नदियों को उपमान के रूप में, मेटाफर के रूप में, और नदियों के लिए मेटाफर्स किस तरह से यूज किए गए हैं, प्रयोग किए गए हैं, ये देखना बड़ा ही रुचिकर है। तो नदियां कहीं प्रणय लीलाओं की साक्षी हैं, जो प्रेम व्यापार हो रहे हैं उसकी साक्षी हैं। कल चर्चा हो रही थी प्राकृत की, तो प्राकृत में गाथा सप्तशती जो है वो लिखी गई है नर्मदा और गोदा, गोदा वस्तुतः गोदावरी ही है, और रेवा जो कि नर्मदा है, तापी इत्यादि नदियों की बार बार चर्चा आती है वहां, और वे उनके प्रेमी युगल जो हैं वो नदियों के कुंज में बने हुए कछारों में मिलते हैं, और नदियां खुद मेटाफर हैं नायिकाओं के लिए। कालिदास ने मेघदूत में बहुत सुंदर वर्णन किया है, नदियों के जो जो वीची हैं, जो तरंग हैं, वो नायिकाओं के भ्रू विलास की तरह हैं। नदी वीच शुभ भ्रू विलास, हाँ ऐसा कालिदास कहते हैं। जीवन के लिए भी नदियां स्वयं उपमान हैं। जलम नदीनाम चंद्रनाम च यौवनम, मनुष्य की जवानी और नदियों का जल, अश्वघोष कहते हैं, जाने पर फिर नहीं आते हैं। तो नदियां जो हैं वो सागर में मिलने की जो परिघटना है, ये फेनोमेनन जो है वो विभिन्न रूपों में देखा गया है। कहीं जीव से ब्रह्म मिल के मिलने की चर्चा है, कहीं उसको समझा गया है, कहीं प्रिया जो है वो प्रिय से मिल रही है, कहीं स्त्री जो है वो पुरुष से मिल रही है, इसके लिए इसको मेटाफर बनाया गया है। इतना ही नहीं, ऐसा सागर को कहीं पिता बनाया गया है और नदियां जो हैं वो पुत्री की तरह उससे मिलती हैं। तो अभी महाराष्ट्र के प्रसिद्ध कवि माडगुळकर को मैं पढ़ रहा था कि वो माहेर जाती हैं और उसी के नाते संपूर्ण सृष्टि जो है वो चल पाती है। तो भिन्न भिन्न रूपों में नदियां हमारे साहित्य में, प्राचीन साहित्य में, मध्यकालीन साहित्य में और आधुनिक साहित्य में भी आती हैं। आधुनिक साहित्य में हम देख रहे थे कि हमारी चर्चा भूपेन हजारिका की बहुत ज्यादा हुई, ये गंगा से वो कंप्लेन कर रहे हैं कि तुम अभी भी क्यों बह रही हो। इसी तरह की ये कविता माडगुळकर की है कि कृष्णा पर वो लिखते हैं कि कृष्णा माई जो है वो संत वाहते कृष्णा माई, वो शांत होकर के बह रही है और उसको कुछ नहीं मालूम, कुछ लेना देना नहीं कि तीर पर जो लोग हैं उनके दुख क्या हैं, उनके कष्ट क्या हैं। तो शायद वो उस चीज की अनुगूंज बहुत पहले वहां आ गई, तीरा वरल्या सुख दुखांसी जानी व तिजला नाही, संत वाहते कृष्णा माई। निरंतर जो है वो कृष्णा शांत होकर के चली जा रही है। तो ये शिकायत जो है नदियों से, शिकायत उसी से की जाती है जिससे हम जिससे बहुत बड़ी अपेक्षाएं रहती हैं। गोपिकाएं कहती हैं कि मधुबन तुम कत रहत हरे, तुम क्यों हरे हो, कृष्ण के वियोग में तुम जल क्यों नहीं जाते हमारी तरह, क्योंकि उनको उनसे अपेक्षा है। तो नदियों से जैसे माँ की उपेक्षा पर संतानें शिकायतें करती हैं, उसी तरह से गंगा से शिकायत अगर कर रहे हैं भूपेन हजारिका तो कृष्णा से भी शिकायत की जा रही है। आज के सत्र में जो दो महत्वपूर्ण पत्र पढ़े जाएंगे उसमें पहला जो है वो रिडेम्पशन नैरेटिव्स एंड एपोथियोसिस ऑफ रिवर्स, इस विषय पर नदियों का देवीकरण, देवीफिकेशन किस तरह से हुआ है और वो क्यों हुआ है, ये बहुत महत्वपूर्ण पत्र है, इसलिए कि वो उसको आर्थिक फैक्टर के साथ जोड़ते हैं और रिडेम्पशन के साथ भी वो जुड़ा हुआ है, पाप मोचन के साथ भी जुड़ा हुआ है नदियों की वो दिव्य विशिष्टता। इस पत्र को प्रस्तुत करेंगे प्रोफेसर विजय कुमार दांता जी, जो कि विभागाध्यक्ष हैं अंग्रेजी विभाग तेजपुर विश्वविद्यालय के। आपकी विशेषज्ञता जो है अमेरिकन लिटरेचर, क्रिटिकल थियरी, फिक्शन स्टडीज, ट्रांसलेशन स्टडीज इत्यादि में है और आप उर्वर लेखक लेखन के धनी हैं। नदियां जो हैं उनको तीर्थ के रूप में जाना जाता है। हम जानते हैं तीर्थ शब्द स्वयं त्रि धातु से संस्कृत के बना है, तरति जो पार कराती हैं, तीर्थ गुरु को भी कहते हैं वस्तुतः, तीर्थंकर इसीलिए कहा जाता है तीर्थंकरों को, क्योंकि हम उसे पार कर पाते हैं। तो एक पाप मोचन का कॉन्सेप्ट उसके साथ लगा हुआ है। तो इस पर मैं अधिक न बोलते हुए प्रोफेसर विजय कुमार दांता जी से आमंत्रित करता हूं, आप हम लोगों को अपने विद्वत्तापूर्ण लेखन से आप लाभित करें। धन्यवाद।
नमस्कार। हाउ मच टाइम डू आई हैव?
20 मिनट का समय हमने रखा है, 20 मिनट्स, और उसके बाद
हाँ ठीक
के बाद हम उस पर चर्चा करेंगे, ऐसा निश्चित हुआ था।
I'm actually thankful to the IIAS, Professor Maghavan Paranpai, old friend brother, and Dr. Anjuman Ara, coordinator, Professor Kailash Baral, of course, and I would also like to thank the chairman for your kind introduction. First of all, I'd like to begin by saying something that I would have said had I gone to Shimla, but then, now that it's not possible, Makram, we have to do it this way. An invitation has to be gratefully acknowledged and diligently acted upon. I have tried to do both, and it's for the Sahiri there to say actually whether I have succeeded or failed, or whether in trying to fail I have succeeded. I also welcome my fellow participants, panelists. I'm sorry to miss actually Venkat Rao in my session, but then I suppose you'll see him tomorrow. I would like to begin by talking about rivers a little. I've always lived by the rivers, actually, two great rivers, except for a brief interlude when I was at Barhampur. When I was close to the sea, I have always, last 60 years of my life, I was always lived by the river. And one is, of course, the Mahanadi of Orissa. And the other one is, the greatest river of the Northeast, the largest, longest possible river of India, the Brahmaputra, sometimes called the Mahabahu. These two rivers have contributed to civilizations, cultures, which go back to the Vedic periods. And I would actually very briefly talk about that. But then as a student of literature, I think I'm always fascinated by the references to rivers, whatever we do. And for me, rivers are as much about floods as about food and fertility of gods and human beings. Also about ghosts and travels, exiles, loss of homes, and opportunities for survival and escape. There are fabulous travel stories and stories of rise and fall of civilizations over and around rivers. My paper has three brief parts. Part one, where I talk about humans as witnesses to whatever rivers have done. Second part, as rivers as witnesses to whatever humans have done. And the third part is as humans as witnesses to whatever humans have done, but then by the sides of the rivers. It's not as clean as it sounds in this division, but then let me start. I begin with a couple of lines from a poem you have all perhaps read and asked your students to read and reread. The sheer power and beauty of these lines. These lines are from a poem by Langston Hughes, the African-American poet, and the title is "The Negro Speaks of Rivers." I quote, "I have known rivers. I have known rivers ancient as the world and older than the flow of human blood in human veins. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. The Negro, in fact, every man of the world, says he has known rivers as diverse as the Euphrates, the Congo, the Nile, and the Mississippi. Significantly, of the last, that is the Mississippi, he says, quote, "I have seen its muddy bosom turn all golden in the sunset. I have known rivers, ancient, dusky rivers," unquote. The river is celebrated by two of the greatest American writers that we've heard of. And I would actually refer to one who later on became an Englishman, by the way. This is T.S. Eliot. And he says, quote, "I do not know much about gods, but I think that the river is a strong brown god." This is in four quartets. Is all but a coin, an American novel, great American novel, Huckleberry Finn, where Huck, a young, poor, white, but white boy, looks at the river at all hours, and he allows the river to flow through his veins, through his consciousness, mythically resuscitating memories that could not be articulated without pain. Huck's pain includes, without his knowing, the pain of the runaway slave Jim. But then that's another subject. Twain's Huck speaks a language that is mnemonic, related to memories. more like a ritual incantation made to please a strange god. We do not understand what we say, but we still pray, incantate, pray. This is an incantation made to a strange god, but that defies narration. We are almost always not trained as students of this novel, not trained to look at the river passages as we are keen on the great friendship story. The river meditation returns to fiction, returns to the novel, almost, you know, very regularly, in a different kind of way in Conrad's Heart of Darkness. In Heart of Darkness, 1901, Conrad's captain Marlowe recalls the Congo River and recalls how the silence of its dark interiors is disrupted by men of war frigates, right, shooting into the forest, not because they have seen or identified an enemy, but because the enemy does not come out. Marlowe's summing up of the now quiet Thames River in England, of course, recollecting, cannot leave out narratives of men sailing to the sea coast and then going out to Africa, to Asia, and to other parts of the world. Marlowe's Thames is not only quiet, but also putrid and stagnant. A proleptic comment on the used-upness of Western imperialism. The same story returns in Naipaul's A Bend in the River, a novel that spares nobody, neither African, nor European, nor Arab, nor Asian, and does not believe in the innocence of human beings. The novel irritated Edward Said so much because of this. I believe you see, and does not believe in the innocence of human beings. The Negro, of course, within quotes, built civilizations, but was destroyed by what seems to be his own insouciance and or the visitor's ingratitude. The story of riparian cultures being swallowed by the river is a chilling reminder of the river as a cold, indifferent witness to human folly or misery. Names may change, even dates and events change, but the archetypal pattern of the river as witness to human folly remains. Let me conclude this section by referring you to two lines most of you possibly recollect from Antony and Cleopatra. I'd rather say two small instances. One is Mark Antony when he says, when challenged by Cleopatra, looks at him and says, let Rome in Tiber melt and the weight and the wide arch of the ranged empires fall. Here is my space, he says, kingdoms are clay. And this is Cleopatra when he gets to know later on that Antony has remarried and she is furious, but she cannot speak anything, only says, melt Egypt into Nile. And kindly creatures turn all to serpents. This is a kind of curse. This is a kind of incantation, a furious incantation, meant not for the river, but for human beings. In the first case, we see Antony's rhetorical devil may care attitude towards Roman politics, his willingness to sacrifice everything, including his Roman family and tradition, for love. However, he remarries and Cleopatra invokes this hugely dystopian and cataclysmic deluge that transforms angels into devilish creatures. Both in subtle ways talk about rivers, swallowing of civilizations, either because of ideological or territorial conflicts. Rivers, in other words, are witness to the rise and fall of cultures. So rivers witness what human beings have done. But then the story is always told by human beings. Given that this is my part two, given that all rivers replenish without failing and take away without fail, they look like gods. Rivers have never been just water bodies and they were never meant to be. Along with the mountains and the oceans, the rivers have been witness to our journey as a species. Literary and cultural texts unfailingly inscribe human responses to the river, both celebratory and critical, incantatory and reflective, but importantly perhaps intimate and intimidating. I'll try to look at both these aspects, but then, you know, let me get back to something that was mentioned yesterday, I think, you know, at greater detail by Professor Baral and Professor Kalidas Mishra, and also by Professor Makarand Palansrai. These are the great Vedic texts. There are great Vedic texts that we recall. Actually, while talking about rivers, and then I don't want to repeat it. Gange cha Yamune chaiva, that one. This, to my mind, is an integrating sloka. And it's in the fitness of things that the IIIS has an integration conference in rivers. Here the Vedic poet is trying, one, to essentialize the Holy Spirit of the great rivers, and two, also signaling a critical geography that will have implications for territorial claims on the part of kings and pilgrims. So the sloka includes additional groups, to my mind. We do not know who these people are exactly, but we know that they are rare people. Lay claims on India as a spiritual geographical imaginary, depending on the contiguity of land masses, but then, importantly, not necessarily under one hegemonic or political umbrella. To my mind, these are perhaps early signs of formalizing a cultural map of what will become India. This is not just a cultural map of an imagined community, but also has seen adequate geographical investments. If we cut out exaggerations, we can see how much of work has gone into transforming accurate topographical knowledge into allegories in our spiritual texts, not the other way around, but that's for another day. Speaking of rivers, we can see in most of our river texts, cumulative knowledge of centuries of travel and exploration, if indeed we can call it so, getting allegorized into ritual formulations or religious texts. This is something that is true to the Vedic texts, especially incantative and poetic compositions getting incorporated into ritual beliefs and acts. While I'm not qualified to speak of the Vedic texts except by way of indirection because of limited and opportunistic forays into Vedic texts, I'd like to quickly read through four texts that show the crystallization of this exploration allegorization continuum. These are famous and beautiful poems, by the way, that we do not anymore recognize as beautiful poems because we look at them as prayers or sing them. Sounds are so beautiful or so frightening that we are absorbed by the incantation, not by the intimate nature of the call anymore. These are Adi Shankara's iconic invocations to Ganga, one of them focusing on a place, in fact, the city of Varanasi and the Manikarnika Ghat, and one is to Yamuna and Narmada. We cannot go to each of these texts, but then we can look at some of these very quickly. I would like to believe that the Narmada Stotram was written at the end, though the encounter with the river seems to have happened early in the Saint poet's life, but one is never sure about the chronology or the sequence. It is, however, evident that already in the 8th century, Adi Shankaracharya, the pilgrim traveler saint, one of the earliest, actually, pilgrim traveler saints of India, sees and worships the river as a deity with extraordinary potential to redeem the sinner. The lines appear, but in poetics, especially in American poetics, we call anagogic or typological strain, where the poet sings as he sees. The poet is a shaman or a mystic, speaking the language of creation and yet creating at the same time. Yatha bairochat vishwam tadaiva parichayate. As he sees the world, he creates. Yet the poet almost becomes the river, in keeping with his Advaitic epistemology, seeing, singing, and celebrating at the same time. Let's actually look at just about four lines from this Ganga Stotram, the longest of all these stotram, by the way. Bhagirathi sukhadayini mata stava jalamahima nigame khyata naham jane tava mahimanam pahi kripamai mama jnanam. See, you know, kind of saluting the river, I don't have to explain. But if you, Mother Bhagirathi, you give joy to all and glory to your water, praise in the scriptures. I do not know your glory fully, cannot sing it fully, but in spite of my lack of ignorance, Mother, please protect me. Mother, please protect me. But then the next line is very important. Abhajen maataha, sota smataha, punarapi jathare, sopi na jataha, narakhani varini, janavi gange, kalusa pabe. This is even greater than the first two lines because already he's extolling the river. Mother, he who has bathed in the flow of your pure water, he will not again take birth from the womb of a mother, human mother. Janavi Ganga, you save people from falling in the Naraka, and then you destroy their impurities. your greatness stands high. Already, I think Ganga is compared to a huge, huge mountain peak. From these lines, we get to see something that is very interesting. On the one hand, the saint poet wants to invest in the river, qualities of a goddess, but then he refuses. Please mark, he refuses. We'll look at his poems closely. He refuses to ignore the materiality of the river. And this becomes clearer as we move to the Yamunastakam, where the story of Krishna is included in the river song and repeatedly invoked, but the same point very significantly refers to the amount of sin and mala. Mala translates into excreta, also to dirt and filth, that the river is to wash and carry. This tells us a story. पुरारिकाय कालिमान लामबारी धारिणी तृणीकृत त्रिविस्तप त्रिलोक शोक हारिणी मनो अनुकुला कुल कुंज कुंज दुदा धर्मदा धुनो तुमे मनोमलम कालिंदी नलिंदी सदा. See, this is a prayer that we sing with a lot of fondness, but then this is also a poem that shows how, you know, the river has, in the process of washing away sins, has accumulated so much that it is already feeling burden. Now, and it becomes even more prominent, more significant and more articulate when you look at, you know, the next four lines that I think I'll quickly read. Malapari malahapari bari puru bhuri mandita pranam malapahari bari pura bhuri mandita amruta prasam prapataka pravachana ati pandita nishan sunanda nanda. And then see, these are the lines where he says that mother salutations. But then, see, look at the significant third line. Your line, your river, your water washes away deep-seated sins of sinners. Deep-seated sins of sinners. And then, of course, you know, wash away my sins. Now, why does a poet is so used to singing the praise of the river, turning the river into a god, also recognize the materiality of the filth that the river carries? The answers, of course, would lie in, you know, the Narmada Astakam, where he even more significantly and even more clearly talks about, you see, what the river carries. And not only does it carry, not only does it talk about the materiality the river's fills, he also talks about the river now is, you know, as empowered to transform social evils. Now imagine an 18th century saint poet talking about the river as a god, talking about the river as a purifier, talking about the river as a social equalizer. And as you move to his, you know, the last significant, possibly, I'm not talking about chronology, but then in the arrangement that we see, it's his incantation of the Varanasi, you know, bathing ghat, the purifying ghat. You see how the saint poet, the 8th century saint poet, moving from deifying the river to looking at the material filth in the river, to looking at the social equalization that the river causes, and finally to looking at the river as a liberator. But then in this Manikantaka, I'm not reading these because that will take time. But then simply I'm saying that when you move through these poems, which we consider prayers, which we sing, which we, you know, kind of recite, and therefore fail to see the movement of different kinds of poetic logic, you find that the poet includes in the river the virtues of a god, the virtues of, you know, a chemist, the virtues of a social equalizer, a reformer, and then finally the virtues of a judge. Now, see, as I said, when you look at these poems, you find a kind of movement from anagogic poetry, where the poet speaks as he's speaking on behalf of God, to a language which we associate with human beings who write poems. Human beings who write poems, we see the singer and the subject becoming one. But then soon, we find that the poet feels the burden of the river. It is like Ahab in Moby Dick feeling the whale while killing it. Or the old man in Hemingway's Old Man of the Sea involuntarily calling the whale brother, a brother that he must kill in order to survive. What I'm suggesting here is that in each of these texts, we find the river being used as a redeeming spirit, but then also as a spirit that loses a lot. But our mythological assets are compensatory. So we kill and celebrate at the same time. If we recall, the Adichie, the old saint, died for Bajra to be created out of his wounds. I see in these prayer poems a conflict between what is often called the anagogic and the analogic, I have said. In the next part, I think I'll just take about 5 minutes. In the next part, I want to refer to a few cultural texts where the river is, you know, seen this way. And one of the texts which is important to my study, but on which I have not been able to comment on fully, is a text by the 15th century saint poet of Assam, Sankaradeva. When he visits Orissa, he writes about the rivers of Orissa with a knowledge, with a geographical knowledge that is astounding. And then he talks about the aquarine flora, the actually the water bodies, the animals and the fish and other species living there with such, you know, with such knowledge, with such sympathy, such details that one has to look at that. But then he talks about the purifying waters of the rivers of Orissa. And then at the same time, he also talks about the food that, you know, the river supply to the people of Orissa. That's a very interesting kind of text. I'm not going in there because I have not worked on the text as of now, you know, not for the paper anyway. The second and my last text actually is a song. And then I would not be singing the song. I cannot also play the song because of my technical difficulties. But then most of you may have, or some of you may have, heard of this song. It is a song, you know, by a man who takes a boat and starts from the westernmost, is an important town of Orissa, Sambalpur, and comes down to the coast where the river meets the sea. Now, this is a very famous song called Jare Bhasi Bhasija. Oh, you know, the boatman tells his boat, my boat, keep going down. And as it goes down, at every small place, at every big place, at every, you know, turn in little cultural changes in Orissa, he addresses somebody, a young maiden, you know, a devotee going to a temple, a farmer farming in his fields, or maybe somebody just singing by the, you know, riverbank. Now, when you look at this particular text, Dare Bhasi Bhasija, and then the signpost that the singer recognizes, you find how much the Mahanadi River, you know, reflects the spirit of Orissa, the cultural shifts from, as you move from Western Orissa through Central Orissa to Coastal Orissa, and you also see the anxiety is brought into the mind of the Oriyas by rapid marches in modernity, rapid or slow marches in modernity. So this is a very significant river song. I will not be able to do justice to the song in a paper like this, but then I would, you know, conclude by referring back to something else that has been bothering me since I agreed to write this paper. Now, on the one hand, I have lived by the Brahmaputra River. I lived, taught in Dibrugarh for close to 20 years on the Brahmaputra River. I teach here in Tejpur. This is again on the Brahmaputra. And to the lives of the people of Assam, the Brahmaputra is a brother, a sister, a father, a friend, and possibly also a fierce competitor. And then so you find in the Brahmaputra, you know, you find actually in the poetry yesterday, Professor Baral talked about Bhupen Hazarika's poetry. You look at any literary creation based on Odisha, you find there will be some reference to the Brahmaputra, either as a brother, as a competitor, as a killer. But then finally, you cannot miss the love of the people for the river because the river is a great provider. Now, you see, once you look at that, you find how Bhupen Hazarika brings in, you know, songs of Paul Robeson, Old Man River, to his Mahabahu Brahmaputra. He calls the Brahmaputra an old man, but then he's also reminded of his own work with, you know, social groups in the United States, Paul Robeson and that the social content of that. And I would, you know, therefore conclude by referring to a wonderful story on the creation of Mahabahu, on the creation of Mahanadi. Because the rivers are created, are deified, but then there are also very fantastic, beautiful stories. Now, there's this nameless sage worshipping in a nameless mountain. And then he had been praying for such a long time that he forgot that it was time to go to the Kumbh Mela. So his friends came and then waited for him for 100 years and then tried to wake him up, but then he did not wake up. He was in deep meditation. So they went off and came back, and each of these rishis came with a little bit of water in their kamandalu, in his kamandalu, and put that water in, you know, this river. He kept on praying for 1,000 years. And when he woke up, carelessly, he kind of hit the kamandalu and the water started flowing. And that became the Mahanadi River. The river of integration of minds, the river of integration of thinking processes, but then in a symbolic way, the river that integrates all rivers. I have grown up by the rivers. I have gone deep with the rivers. Thank you so much. And then thank you very much for listening to me with patience. Shukla-san.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद प्रोफेसर दांता आपके और महत्वपूर्ण विभाषण के लिए. आपने मुख्य रूप से शंकराचार्य के तीन स्तोत्रों गंगा यमुना और नर्मदा के लिखी गई स्तोत्रों को आगे करके आपने रिडेम्पशन का जो सिद्धांत है नदियों के साथ मिला करके उसका उस पर बहुत अच्छा प्रकाश डाला. एक छोटी सी बात ये थी कि जो गंगे च यमुने चैव गोदावरी सरस्वती इत्यादि श्लोक है वो वस्तुतः वेद का नहीं है, वो मंत्र नहीं है वस्तुतः. वो क्योंकि वेद में कहीं भी कृष्णा कावेरी यहाँ तक कि संभवतः नर्मदा का नाम नहीं आता, वो सप्त सिंधु इत्यादि का आता है. बहरहाल आपके बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण उद्गार के लिए आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. अब अगले पत्र के लिए हम प्रोफेसर सुबीर धर जी को आमंत्रित करेंगे.
एक सेकंड शुक्ला जी, जस्ट एक्चुअली आई एम सो सॉरी दैट एक्चुअली आई शुड हैव सेड स्क्रिप्चरल टेक्स्ट, स्क्रिप्चरल और वैदिक.
यस यस श्योर वैदिक
स्क्रिप्चरल, वैदिक नहीं, वैदिक नहीं, हां वैदिक नहीं. थैंक यू सो मच.
यू आर वेलकम सर.
सो प्रोफेसर शुक्ला
जी, जी 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 प्लीज.
मुझे लगता है सुबीर सर ज्वाइन नहीं कर पाए हैं, तो हम लोग उनका लिंक में ले सकते हैं. अभी चांद वासा रेडी है तो, लेकिन हमारे पास
यू विल बी रीडिंग अ पेपर ऑफ प्रोफेसर डी वेंकटराव. तो अलंकार कौशिक जी आए क्या? ही कुडंट ज्वाइन आई थिंक.
हेलो
अलंकार कौशिक जी.
Arzuman ji, what is the issue now?
Sridhar could not join, sir. Till now he is not online.
But he didn't tell you anything. You showed him the program, or he doesn't know about the program?
I called him around 6 times, sir. He is not taking the call. He just sent the message that he has some issues with Cisco. So Chand Vasa is ready with his paper. So we can go ahead with that.
Yeah. Please, let's go ahead with the next one. And in the meanwhile, you try to talk to him, Professor Dhar, and I hope that he can join in the next session, okay? And I think immediately after this, I request Balram ji, aap bhi shayad Ramashankar ji se ek baar baat kar chuke hain, to unko bhi puch sakte hain. Ye satra ki samapti ke baad, आप उनको एक बार दोबारा पूछ लें कि वो अगर इसमें शामिल हो सकते हैं तो सेकंड हाफ में हम देखते हैं ना
स्पीच के लिए ना पत्रकार के लिए.
हाँ जी, हाँ जी. अब इसके बाद आप अगले प्रपत्र को आगे ले लीजिए. है
बिल्कुल अगला पत्र तो प्रोफेसर सुबीर धर वो आ नहीं रहे हैं तो So, Dr. Professor Arzuman Ara will be reading the paper of Professor D. Venkatrao, isn't it like that?
No, bilkul nahi. Who will speak now?
Sir, I have a small suggestion. Let's have the discussion on Professor Danta's paper.
Yeah.
And then we start the next session because we have only few minutes left for this session.
तब तक वो संभवतः अलंकार जी आ जाएं.
We still have four papers. No, who is the next speaker? Let's take two papers together. Which is the second next one? Who's ready?
Actually, next paper is out of my chair. So we have to check.
No, that's okay. That's okay. Aap do ko karenge. So you just invite the next speaker, please. We have to adjust a little bit. So go ahead.
I will have to keep it.
Next
speaker is Dr. Shauna Barik.
Yes, please take the second paper also. Yes, then we'll have a discussion.
Uncanny Indian Rivers in the British Mindset in Late 19th Century. So, kya speaker hai hamare paas? Dr. Shauna Barik. Dr. Shauna Barik hai kya?
I don't see her online, sir.
Arzuman ji, who's the speaker you were telling us about who's ready?
Chand Vasa, sir. He's online.
Okay. Next, Dr. Chand Vasa.
Bas. You take Dr. Chand Vasa ji and you contact the others and let us know where they are, you know. See, we have to do this at the beginning of the day, that is at 3 o'clock, at 2:30. We should know who is ready, who is not, you know. We can't leave it at the last minute, okay? Let's take Dr. Chand Vasa, please. Go ahead.
So, I'm inviting Dr. Chand Vasa ji for his paper, that is River of Plenty Voices, Narratives of Modernity and Disposition of D'Souza's Island. Dr. Chand Vasa. Dr. Chand Vasa, can you hear my voice?
He should unmute his mic, no?
Please unmute your mic.
The video may be
Your mic is mute. Just please unmute your mic and then start speaking. Your mic is still muted.
He is unmuted from the side of the host. He needs to be unmuted. He is muted from the side of the host.
System analyst.
Unmute him.
आपका सवाल चुके थे लेकिन उस
इट्स माय ऑनर एंड प्रिविलेज टू प्रेजेंट पेपर इन द प्रेजेंस ऑफ इंटेलेक्चुअल्स लाइक प्रोफेसर मकरंद Chipai, Santa sir, Ajman, Ara, Professor Amit, thank you. The title of my paper is River of Two Voices. And I have a bit slight change in the title of modern displacement.
चांद बादशाह जी आप प्लीज अपने अपने माइक को थोड़ा सा नजदीक करके हाँ इस तरह बोलें तो आवाज आ रही है अच्छी
Sure, sir. Now thank you. Sorry for the inconvenience.
Please go on.
Yeah, the title is River of Plenty Voices, Narratives of Modernity and Displacement in Nath D'Souza's novel, The Island, Dvipa. This is the original title. And it has been, originally, the author, D'Souza, wrote it in Kannada language and later it got translated. I'll try to show a few slides. My laptop is not supporting Cisco, unfortunately, so I have downloaded a few slides on my mobile device. So I'll try to show if a few slides so that. Okay. I'm sorry, it's not supporting the slides. Apologies. Like in today's paper, I'm going to talk about the novel Dvipa, Island. Dvipa means island. The literary cultures of Kannada attribute multiple meanings to various rivers which are flowing in the geography of Karnataka. So in the public memory and folklore of the state, various cultural locations and pilgrim places share a mythical and syncretic cultural affiliation with rivers which are there in the geographical map of Karnataka. The 9th century poet Sri Vijaya uses the rivers to describe or measure the territory of the land of Kannada speakers in monumental work Kaviraja Marga. Kaviraja Marga means royal path for poets. I'm reading out one of the important passages from the work. "Twixt sacred river twain it lies, from fame to Godavari, to where the pilgrim rest his eyes on holy Kaveri." Unquote. So this is this very fascinating poem about the geography. I mean, this particular, these lines have been used to understand the map of Karnataka. So Sri Vijaya uses rivers to identify the location of Karnataka here. That is something very fascinating. Earlier have the concept of contours and all the things. So rivers themselves of measurement parameters to identify locations. The state poet G.S. Shivarudrappa, his name is G.S. Shivarudrappa, the state poet of Karnataka. He uses the river as a metaphor to desire and journey of the soul towards attaining a spiritual freedom that assures escape from the material world. I am reading the translation of the famous poem. It's a famous poem in Kannada language. I'm reading the translation of the poem, first passage from the poem. "Desire of river, to unseen sea mind is desiring. Can I see one day? Can I join sea one day?" So here the poet uses a river as a metaphor to his own individuality. Simultaneously, another state poet, Dara Bendre, personifies the river Shalmala. River Sharmala as a beloved companion and a site of belongingness which second the full-fledged wisdom of an individual. The real rivers that appear in the Kannada literature are ascribed with multiple metaphorical meanings. River is a source of hope, an identity, a metaphor to beloved. So river becomes a site of cultural belongings as well. So having said it, the novella Island, translated into English in 2013, written by the famous contemporary Kannada novelist and short story writer Nar D'Souza, unfolds myriad associations developed between Sharavati. Sharavati is one of the principal rivers flowing in Malnadu territories of the region, one of the important rivers in the Western Ghats. He talks about various association developed between the river and natives living in the Western Ghats of Karnataka. And the most important thing is D'Souza is known as the submersion writer because most of his works extensively grapple with predicaments of people who were living in the river basins of Sharavati hydroelectric project or Linganamakki dam. I'll try to show the map. Please pardon me if my handset does not support slideshow, but I have like slide for the understanding them and also show. I hope the participants and scholars, the slides are visible to you. Could you kindly confirm
whether? Yes, they are. Yes, they are visible. Yes,
we can see that. It's okay.
This is the passage which I had quoted, read out. The novel which I'm talking about, Deep Island, author is, and he's famously known as a merchant writer. And some of his works, which grapple with the predicates of.
Your voice is not coming properly, please.
Yeah.
Now just.
Dvipa, Mulukade, Hariyuva Nadi, Vaddu. These are the works which extensively talk about people who got displaced because of, Linganamakki Dam built across Sharavati River in the western Ghats of Karnataka. I'm trying to give you the geographical location of Linganamakki Dam. Kindly look at the Karnataka map, please. And the location of the dam is highlighted with a red point. So that is where Linganamakki Dam was constructed. So here, the submersion writer leverages on his 25 years of work experience in the areas connected with the Sharavati hydroelectric project, and hence he strengthens his narratives. The novelist is a government employee, and he had worked in the Department of Hydroelectric Project. He has contributed a significant body of narratives to the Kannada literature, and the narrative, the body of narratives he has created, they are known as submersion literature in Kannada literature. His narratives give a mimetic representation to problems created by the construction of the dam. Hence the story, particularly the story in the novel, becomes voice of the various families which got displaced and went through indescribable angst of losing and leaving their living places behind. In the process, the writer also keenly narrativizes multiple modes in which cultures and lives of people living in the Sharavati basin also vanish in the bustling progress of modernity. The image of the dam becomes a mean of modernity. So the novella provides counter narratives on modernity and the plight of families stranded in the island. Hence, he exposes the darker sides of modernity at large. The novella is one of the important stations in the narratives of submersion. His works such as Dvipa, Island, Mulugade, Submersion, Flowing River, and Vaddu, they significantly narrativize the pain of displaced people. The existing scholarship on the text seems to apply the idea of displacement to families who lived in the basins of the river. But what personally I felt is that I find that the existence of the river Sharavati is also violently distorted. The novella relies on metaphorical referents that disclose the various threats to the sundry identities of the river. Owing to the construction of the dam and also hydroelectric project across the river, the character of the river is also transformed here. A life-supporting river is made to aggressively destroy the lives of natives who had worshipped it since time immemorial. In the process of changing role of the river, not only people but also various rituals and cultural practices vanish in the bustling sound of the rising river. For instance, the father of the protagonist, father named Dugacha, he is actually known for the performance of Nema. Nema is a ritual of foretelling of the future of various events. Dugacha, the father of the protagonist, inherited this tradition of Nema from his ancestors. While performing the rituals, he is given due respect and enough money for livelihood by the village's landlords. The Nema ritual becomes a source of sustenance and, most importantly, cultural identity of the family of the protagonist. His family and sensibilities are deeply rooted in the soil and roots of the island. Contradictingly, the urban space which does not need Nema practice. That's what we get to understand in the novel as we move, scribble through pages. Hence, Dugaja cannot perform the Nema ritual in urban space. His son Ganapaya was neither rich nor poor as long as he was staying on the island called Hosamanehalli. He used 2 acres of wetland to grow areca and 3 acres of agricultural land to grow rice. But the sudden shift of home from the Hosamane village, which becomes an island later because of the rising level of water in Sharavati basins, to a nearby town invokes a sense of cultural crisis and, most importantly, homelessness in the psyche of both father and son. Conversely, Benjamin says, there is no document of civilization which is not at the same time a document of barbarism. The process of liberalization and globalization and privatization in the last few decades has accelerated the transformation of India as a nation state. The primary in this process, the primary social institutions of India, such as the village, joint family system, and sensibilities of communities are under significant change. That's the that's the way narrative of the novel try to disclose the changing scenario of Indian social order. As Nehru has said, dams are the temples of modern India. But the novelist says that dams are also causing a displacement of families. And the novelist, Nard D'Souza, does this job effectively. That's what I feel. The land and money given by the government, because he himself was an officer in the submersion of office located in the in Shumuga. So what he observed is that the land and money given by the government do not substitute the sense of belongingness towards the places. Many tribal communities refuse to go to urban locations. Further, in his one of his interviews, D'Souza recounts how cattle, which were also displaced and taken to far off places by their owners, returned to one of the villages, which is now submerged in the backwaters of the Sharavati River. So this is something, this kind of examples are used by the writer to highlight the intensity of sense of belongingness and also the displacement caused by dams across Sharavati River. Mega development programs such as dams and mining projects accelerate the displacement phenomena. While these projects generate benefits for the few relatively better off sections of the population, they also at the same time marginalize the poorer sections of the society. So various research works claim that Sardar Sarovar Dam has displaced more than 2 lakh people. And about 56% of them are indigenous or Adivasis. The Linganamakki Dam has also created similar problems in the lives of people who lived in these villages in the basins. According to the author, the government claimed to have resettled the majority of them. Governments claim that the majority of them have been resettled, but the resettled people face serious problems, lack of sense of belongingness and sense of out of place. They're all haunting. That's the kind of observation Nard D'Souza does in his works, and particularly this novel, Dvipa or Island, highlights the intensity of displacement. The story unfolds the way new projects assist in the growth of cities in distance and disturb the existence of the river and its divine association with natives living on the bank of the river. I had quoted Nema practice, how Nema practice had become source of livelihood and sustenance and cultural identity of the protagonist in the novel. And now, hence they are being displaced. It's unlikely that they get due respect in urban spaces. One fine morning, Ganapaya, the protagonist in the novella, wakes up to witness the alarming changes in the natural flow of the river of Das. I'm quoting one of the passages from the novel. how particular passage helps us understand observations of the author as well as the protagonist in the novel. Even as he walked down the slope, he saw the Sharavati. Previously, before the dam had risen, the river flows was towards the waterfall. Now he could see the water, but not the flow. With the dam blocking its way, it had stopped right there beside the hillock, restless and choppy. Just the previous week, he could see the tips of the boulders on the hill. The water had not risen much, but now it had widened the riverbed on the side away from the hill and was threatening to overflow the bank. The Sharavati lay like a pregnant woman, full, ready for birth. Unquote. The Hosamane village, which becomes an island later on, as of now it is surrounded by the rising water and the village becomes an island. The brilliance of the author lies in transforming the island into a site of contrapuntal relations among the members of the family of Dugacham. His son Ganapaya lands in an unspeakable anguity raised by the anxiety of leaving the island and also overlooking the wish of his father. His father at any cost wanted to stay there in the Hosamane village or island till his last breath. But Dugacha passes away in the middle of the story. That's a different portion of the discussion. The unspeakable anguish of being detached from the rest of the world widens the relation between husband and wife as well, his wife Nagavini and husband. Ironically, the isolation of the family fails to unite its members. The isolation is accompanied with the fear of submersion caused by the river. The inner self of Nagamani attains an identity crisis with the arrival of Krishnaya, who was a childhood friend and her father's home. At her father's home, each individual behaves differently in times of crisis in the novella. The spectrum of hope, faith, trust, belief, fear, humanity, they all can be debated and elaborated through the perspectives of these three members of the family in times of crisis caused by rising river. The river Sharavati becomes a testimonial site of polemical narratives that range from the anxiety of being ignored by modernity to the ambiguity of being in a helpless situation in the process of making oneself visible. The island becomes a sign of hope, but the rising river at the back of the dam threatens not only the hope of sustaining their land and home, but also the lives of the family members. The book is further enriched by D'Souza's lived experience in the very environs where his novels are set. The story comes out from a deeply supported ethnographic description, albeit the story is a fairly simple novella. The novelist worked in the Karnataka Public Work Department, as I said at the beginning of my presentation. He worked in the Karnataka Public Works Department in Linganamakki, the place where the dam is constructed across Sharavati River. Hence, he observes the predicament of people who became the subject of displacement in the Malnadu regions. So, in the author's note to the novella, the writer gives testimonial accounts of the suffering of these people. He says the villagers were compensated with money and land elsewhere. I've seen people dismantling their homes, loading their extended families, their belongings onto lorries and bullock carts, and going away to wherever land was allotted to them. But who helped them cope with their grief and fear, having to uproot themselves from everything familiar, from a way of life based on a value system they had known for generations? Nobody thought of that. On the other hand, crafty government officials exploited these people who were ignorant of the ways of the outside world. They sought bribes, they harassed and cheated them. So this is a personal observation not D'Souza does in his office. And he observes the plight of a particular family which used to frequently visit the office in order to get compensation. So the pain of a particular family living on the basin of Sharavati River motivates him to pen down such a fascinating novella. The novel is he shares personal empathy with the poor family which lost its shelter after the completion of the Sharavati dam. The compensation for the family was not yet decided, but the water of the river reach the threshold of the family. Husband and wife went through a strange trauma of being out of the place. The plight of the family inspired him to write the novella thus. So he says, I poured my sorrow at their plight into Dvipa. It is the story of a man who is forced to lose his community identity and fails to cope with his newfound individuality. So, adding to the observation of the author, loss of identity is seen not only in the man, but also the river Sharavati. As the novel progresses, the Sharavati River becomes the source of fear. Earlier, it was a site of devotion, but now, because of the construction of dam, the Sharavati River causes fear among the family. The writer pervades the effects of the dam project on the ecological chain. The story says that not only human beings, but also animals feel dislocated and try to occupy new territories where human beings live. The life of animals is also disturbed. That's the image we get in the novel. Wild animals like the tiger, cheetah, bison, and wild boar lived in the Malnadu forest, but they lived in their own territory most of the time. Now, with all the extra water around, they could be scared too. There's a lot more to discuss about the presence of animals in the novel. I will reserve it for the discussion portion. Simultaneously, the story unfolds the changing nature of the relationship among the family members of Ganapaya. In the plot, Nagaveni and her husband Ganapaya are forced to stay back, even while their fields are under threat of being submerged by the water. A shade of complexity rises with the arrival of Krishnappa, who comes to stay with the family as per the suggestion of Nagaveni's father. He's an indispensable farmhand. Both Nagaveni and Krishnappa are fond of each other since childhood. Nagaveni's mother moderated their emotional attachment and behaviors in childhood. Krishnappa can also be metaphorically compared with the dam. So that's what I observe. His arrival, which disturbs the relation between the dam. If you compare Krishnappa, disturb the relation between Nagaveni, wife, and husband, Ganapaya. Simultaneously, the dam disturbs the relation between the river and families living on the back of the river. Ganapaya is caught between the betrayal of the river Sharavati and the disappointment with the corrupt government officials. So he's disappointed because his father has performed Dema rituals for generations, and Sharavati river was treated as a source of devotion. So now he sees that Sharavati river has betrayed him. That's the kind of understanding he gets when he observes the rising level of water. His wife's excitement towards her childhood friend intensifies his existential crisis as well. A closer reading, however, reveals the ambiguous metrics that fits together into the elegant montage of D'Souza's narratives. As a reader, I see a parallel story, the visibility of the human-made disastrous on nature and the self-imposed complexity of Ganapaya in understanding the declining relationship with his wife. So his pain is doubleless, the pain of having lost the source of survival and also the angst of losing companionship. Hence, as the river rises, the intensity of ambiguity also rises. The parallel meaning keeps the tale interlinked with dilemmas. Ganapaya's vacillation about leaving the place or whether to stay back until his last breath. The struggles of Krishnappa and Nagaveni, who are caught between their unspeakable desires and taboos of marital fidelity and virtue. So, D'Souza's narrative uses this counterpoint, the more darker sides of modern development, which cuts some more profound than other. The relationship of nature, curious blend of attachment and fear, reverence and hostility. The novella hence, as the reviewer Naresh Kirti points out, the novella is used to connote isolation in the spatial as well as emotional senses. So at the climax of the novella, both Krishna and Nagaveni immerse in the waters of Sharavati and die. This episode gives a tragic sense. Metaphorically, they both attain moksha, by losing their lives in the same river. The river hence becomes a metaphorical site to unification of two souls. The river also becomes a site of various memories and testimony of predicaments of members of the family which was living in Hosamane village. So Isoja leverages on his observations while weaving the narratives of the novel. So what I feel is that the novella overall, perhaps it is first kind of experiment, or maybe one of the most important significant experiments done by a writer in the context of Kannada literature to talk about modernity and displacement, dams, construction of dams as metaphor to modern displacement as the darker side of modernity. So with this, I will stop my presentation. If there are questions, doubts, suggestions, I'll be more than happy to address them.
बहुत धन्यवाद डॉक्टर चांद बाशा इस महत्वपूर्ण प्रस्तुति के लिए. शरावती को लेकर के जो उपन्यास लिखा गया आइलैंड, उस पे आपने उसमें जो वर्णित विभीषिका है डैम्स के, वो उसको आपने बहुत अच्छी तरह से वर्णित किया. शरावती पुराने स्क्रिप्चर्स में या साइंटिफिक टेक्स्ट्स में एक ऐसी नदी के रूप में आती है जो कि पूर्वी भारत को पश्चिमी भारत से अलग करती है. अष्टाध्यायी की एक बहुत प्रसिद्ध टीका है काशिका. काशिका में एक बहुत सुंदर सा श्लोक उस शरावती नदी को प्रणाम करते हुए कहा गया है कि प्रागुदंचौ विभजते हंस क्षीराम्बुनि यथा विदुषाम शब्द सिद्ध्यर्थम सान पातु शरावती. जैसे हंस जो है वो दूध को पानी से अलग कर देता है, ये एक एक काव्यात्मक रूढ़ ही है, उसी प्रकार शरावती नदी जो है वो पूरब और पश्चिम को अलग करती है. तो इस तरह से भारत को कि पूरब और पश्चिम, वेस्ट और ईस्ट में विभाजक रेखा की तरह शरावती नदी को माना जाता था. इतनी महत्वपूर्ण नदी पर इतने इंटरेस्टिंग नॉवेल पर आपने चर्चा की, आपका बहुत धन्यवाद. अब जैसा कि निदेशक महोदय का ये निर्देश था, सुझाव था, हमारे बहुत ही ऊर्जस्वी, उत्साही और सर्वप्रिय अध्येता रहे जो डॉक्टर रमाशंकर सिंह जी, हम उनसे थोड़ा सा सुनना चाहते हैं क्योंकि इस विषय पर उनका शोध है और उन्होंने उन्होंने पिछले सत्र में, पिछले दो वर्षों में इसी विषय पर नदियों पर शोध किया और नदियों और निषादों पर एक बहुत ही सुंदर सेमिनार भी कराया था. उनको लिंक भेजा जा चुका है, मुझे लगता है कि अभी वो रमाशंकर जी आप हैं क्या, संभवतः अभी वो जुड़ नहीं पाए हैं. तो
हेलो
प्रोफेसर अर्जुन आरा, क्या हमारे पिछले पिछले
सुविधर इज ट्राइंग
टू कनेक्ट. प्रोफेसर सुविधर इज जॉइंट. सो या हेलो सुविधर,
ओके ओके. सो आई एम नाउ इनवाइटिंग प्रोफेसर सुविधर, फॉर्मर हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश एंड डायरेक्टर टैगोर गांधी सेंटर, Rabindra Bharati University, to present his paper on Rabindranath Tagore, Rivers of Public in Imagination. Welcome, sir.
Right. First of all, I'd like to begin with a double apology. Apology number one, because you see, I've changed the title of my paper. Now it's a paper no longer on imagination, but it's a paper which I'm calling Rabindranath Tagore, Rivers and the Discourse of Power. The second apology is because, you know, I don't think this is a complete paper as such. It's more a work in progress. But anyway, I'm sure, it hangs together. So you should be able to hopefully understand what I'm trying to get at. I'll start off by saying, writing in his book, Power, a Philosophical Analysis, Peter Morris makes a pertinent observation that, quote, whilst many events can be described as an exercise of power, we should only use the vocabulary of power if you are interested specifically in the capacity for producing events of this sort, and not if we are just interested in the events themselves, unquote. This is a salutary corrective given the fact that what seems to arrest the notice of the individual journalist, literary writer, or even the occasional theorist in the contemporary Western world seems to be instances and locations of the immediate fallouts of power, whether the Holocaust or Stalinism or Vietnam or 9/11. What is often to be found largely missing in works of literature, in say a novel like Guy Lillo's Falling Man, is a recent reflection on the nature of power. Arguably, just such an investigation of the idea of power may be noticed in several places in Tagore's markings on rivers, in his poems and fiction, and particularly in his discursive texts, essays and addresses, and his philosophical writings, which will be the specific focus of this paper. Not that Tagore was uninterested in the events of rivers themselves, for throughout his vast oeuvre, he not only described rivers, but also held them to be central to his thoughts and as a key to his realizations about existence and being in general. Yet, he was insistent about what we called the, quote, transversal, unquote, powers embodied by rivers, the idea that the force majeure of a moving volume of water was something that went beyond the constraints of set political borders and perceived national identities. Rivers, Tagore recognized as sites of power capable of affecting the lives of the individuals living in close proximity to them and depending on them for their lives or livelihood. There is a clear sighting, too, on the part of Tagore, that rivers may be forces which may exercise unrestrained power over the physical bodies of men, affect their well-being or their workings, shape their very lives and deaths. It is a characteristic feature of power, writes Foucault, that power, quote, separates the individual, breaks his link with others, splits up community life, forces the individual back on himself, and ties him to his own identity in a constraining way, unquote. In a very cogent sense, this is precisely what is indicated about rivers in several of Tagore's fictions. It is a well-known fact that Tagore's familiarity with riverine Bengal came about with his taking up, at the behest of his father Devendranath, the management of the family's zamindari estates in Birhampur, Kaligram, and Shojodpur, all three places now in Bangladesh. This, after a former childhood sojourn, was his second visit to the land on the banks of the river Poddar. But now, compelled to take up residence there, Tagore often preferred to live and write in the large and comfortable family houseboat which he had had brought up from its anchorage in the river Hooghly in Kolkata. In this vessel, Tagore often sailed up the Ichamoti, Boral, and Athrai rivers on his zamindari work. Impressions of these are reflected in many of his short stories, poems, and particularly in the letters he wrote to his mother Indira Devi from 1888 to 1895, literary epistles that were to be later published as Chinnapothro. These, as Pramodnath Bishi evocatively calls them, amounted to being a virtual, quote, epic of the Padma, unquote. Indeed, as translator William Radice has noted to Tagore, quote, the river is a symbol of the spirit that impels all thinking things, all objects of all thought, and rules through all things, through human life as much as through the natural, non-human world, unquote. Of course, this is a rather simplistic assessment of a complex engagement, for rivers were far more to us to Tagore than a kind of Wordsworthian pantheistic soul consciousness. Michel Foucault has spoken about how, quote, for some people, asking questions about the how of power would limit them to describing its effects without ever relating those effects either to causes or to a basic nature. It would make this vow a mysterious substance which they might hesitate to interrogate in itself, no doubt because they would prefer not to call it into question. By proceeding in this way, which is never explicitly justified, it's a kind of fatalism, unquote. Nevertheless, as Foucault continues, power, quote, is something which exists with three different qualities: its origin, its basic nature, and its manifestations, unquote. The manifestations of the power of rivers is especially evident in the short stories of Tagore. In fiction, the river is cited as a site of social negotiations, economic activity, individual aspirations, separations and reunions, and, not infrequently, as a potent agency. The very first short story that Tagore wrote, a tale called Nodir Ghat, or the River Stairs, which has a narrative river, the human protagonist, a widow who falls in love with a sannyasi, commits suicide by drowning herself in the Ganga. The last lines of the story read, quote, "The moon set, the night grew dark, I heard a splash in the water. The wind raved in the darkness as if it wanted to blow out all the stars of the sky," unquote. In the story, the child's return, a monsoon rain-swollen river swallows up an infant and sets in train a series of events stained with tragic consequences. The lines in question, even though this is an extended quotation, read, quote, "But the fact that he had been forbidden to go near the water immediately attracted the boy's mind away from the Kodumbo flowers and towards the water. He saw it gurgling and swirling along as if a thousand wavelets were naughtily, merrily escaping to a forbidden place beyond the reach of some mighty Raichara. The boy was thrilled by their mischievous example. He gently stepped down from his chair and edged his way to the water. Picking a long reed, he leant forward, pretending that the reed was a fishing rod. The romping, gurgling wavelets seemed to be murmuring an invitation to the boy to come and join their game. There was a single plopping sound, but on the banks of the Padma River in monsoon spate, many such sounds can be heard. Raicharan had filled the fold of his dhoti with kadamba flowers. Climbing down from the tree, he made his way towards the push chair, smiling. But then he saw that the child was not there. Looking all around, he saw no sign of him anywhere. His blood froze. The universe was suddenly unreal, pale and murky as smoke. A single desperate cry burst from his breaking heart. Master, little master, my sweet, good little master. But no one called out Channa in reply. No childish, mischievous laugh came back. The Padma went on rushing and swirling and gurgling as before, as if it knew nothing and had no time to attend to the world's minor occurrences, unquote. Instances like this can be multiplied, but it is not only in the fiction that such evocations of the powers of river can be found. In some of Tagore's lyrics, the river in power is gentle and intimate, as it is here in one of the poet's simplest and best known poems. Quote, "Our little river flows in graceful loops. The summer heat dries her up to a gentle flow. Both cart and cattle travel across with ease. Her banks are high, her depths are shallow. The sand bed glitters, no trace of mud. The far bank shimmers with the kash flowers white, where flocks of mynas chirp busily all day, and jackal calls arise at night," unquote. The economy of power that the above lines define is that of a soft amenability which is conjoined, if not equated, with beauty. For instance, both cart and cattle travel across with ease. The river is graceful and gentle. It is non-threatening to human and animal life with its high banks and shallow depths. And it is clear and clean with only a bed of glittering sand and no bed. Writing on the notion of power, the European social scientist Stefano Ruzzini makes the important point that power implies an idea of counterfactuals. That is, it could also have been otherwise. The counterfactual to the lyric Our Little River is instanced in a poem titled Popeye, published in the volume Pumuschu. Here, we are given a contrast between the mighty Padda and the little Popeye that flowed near the poet's abode in Shantiniketan. Of the Padma River, Tagore writes, and once again an extended quotation, the whole village stands shuddering in constant fear of the heartless stream. The proud river has a name in the venerable texts. Through her veins run the sacred current of the Ganges. She remains remote. The homestead she passes by are tolerated by her, not recognized. Her stately manner has a response in it to the majestic silence of the mountain and the large loneliness of the sea. Unquote. Unlike the little river of the earlier lyric, which had been given an imaginative integration with the pulses of quotidian life, especially the natural, for instance, the kash flowers, as the human, the cart, and the animal, both domesticated, the cattle, and the wild, the jackal, the Padma is limned in terms of grandeur. The river is said to be proud and heartless, and the village people are described as living in fear of it. It has a sacred lineage, and it stays aloof, distant, and almost scornful of the habitations that are interspersed along its banks. The whole is a depiction cast in the aura of the sublime, of, quote, the majestic silence of the mountain and the large loneliness of the sea, unquote. But after this, in the same Pumuschu poem, there comes an evocation of the small Popeye River near the poet's own Shantiniketan. And I quote some lines from this. I have for my neighbor the tiny river Popeye. She lacks the distinction of ancient lineage. The primitive name of hers is mixed up with the loud laughing prattle of the Shautal women of countless ages. There's no gap for discord between the land and water in her intimacy with the village. And she easily carries the whisper of her one bank to the other. The blossoming flax field with her as the young shoots of rice. Where the road comes to an abrupt break at the brink of her water, she graciously makes a way for passers-by across her crystal-clear garrulous stream. Her speech is the rhythm of the humble home, not the language of the learned. Her rhythm has a common kinship with both the land and the water, and so on. So, it has been said that the concept of power is fundamentally identical to the concept of the political. That is, to include something as a factor of power in one's calculus means to politicize it. In other words, attributing a function of power to an issue imports it into the public realm where action or non-action is asked to justify itself. This description of the contrary agencies of river power can lend themselves to at least three varieties of dichotomous interpretation. The first, helpful and cooperative versus intimidating. The second, big agency versus small. The third, ghor or home versus bahir or world. These are all familiar tropes in the venue of Tagore literature, but there's yet another aspect of the power dynamics of the river in this aesthetico-intellectual territory that I would like to draw your attention to. And this is of a form of power that Foucault, drawing in all probability on René Guyon, calls, quote, salvation-oriented as opposed to political power, oblative as opposed to the principle of sovereignty, individualizing as opposed to legal power, coextensive and continuous with life and linked with the of the individual himself, unquote. There are several texts in which Tagore speaks of rivers and their power, figured in such a hypostatic context. But the one I will use here is Shadhana, The Realization of Life. In the third of the essays in this volume, which incidentally had 8 reprints in the very first year of its publication, Tagore notes that, quote, the river has boundaries, its banks, unquote, but then goes on to ask, quote, river all banks, or are the banks the final facts about the river? Do not these obstructions themselves give its water an onward motion? Unquote. What we have here is an alternative visualization of the power of rivers, one seen not in terms of different versions of an innate natural physical agency set apart from other greater or lesser forces, human or mechanical, as in the play Muktodhara, for instance, but in terms of a productive dialectics. Tagore made his implication clear by recounting a personal experience of being on one occasion immobilized in a boat upon a river. And I quote, "Once, while passing under a bridge, the mast of my boat got stuck in one of its girders. If only for a moment, the mast would have bent an inch or two, or the bridge raised its back like a yawning cat, or the river given in, it would have been all right with me. But they took no notice of my helplessness." This is the very reason why I could make use of the river and sail upon it with the help of the mast. The current was inconvenient. I could rely on the bridge. Things are what they are, and we have to know them if we would deal with them. And knowledge of them is possible because our wish is not their law. This knowledge is a joy to us. But the knowledge is one of the channels of our relationships with the things outside us.
Professor Dhar, please conclude it. Please conclude the paper. We are running out of time.
Right.
Sorry to disturb you.
मैं भी फोन पे ही करता हूँ, उनको मैसेज कर रहा हूँ।
ओहो, चार उत्तेजक किस्म के पत्र थे, और पहला पत्र प्रोफेसर विजय कुमार दांता का था, जो रिडेम्पशन नैरेटिव्स पर था, और इस विषय पर मैं प्रश्नों को आमंत्रित करता हूँ। जो लोग प्रश्न पूछना चाहते हैं अध्येताओं में, विद्वानों में, वे स्वयं अपने को अनम्यूट करके प्रश्न पूछ लें सीधे डायरेक्ट प्रोफेसर विजय कुमार दांता जी से। जी
मेरी पहले वक्ता प्रोफेसर दांता से के सामने एक जिज्ञासा है कि नदियों की एक रोमांटिक और रचनात्मक भूमिका तो हमारे साहित्य में मिलती है, उसकी उनकी एक विध्वंसकारी भूमिका भी है। हमारे पारंपरिक साहित्य में अक्सर उसकी चर्चा नहीं होती, इसका क्या कारण?
इंग्लिश में आंसर देने से आपको प्रॉब्लम, क्योंकि मैं हिंदी में बोलूंगा।
बोले, नो प्रॉब्लम
गलत हो जाएगा।
नहीं, बोले।
एक बात ऐसा है कि थैंक यू फॉर द क्वेश्चन। एक बात ऐसा है कि ऐसा भी नहीं है कि उसमें कहीं चर्चा नहीं है। ये बात जरूर है कि रिवर्स के बारे में जितने सारे लिख हम पढ़ते हैं उसमें बहुत सारे रोमांटिक है, लेकिन कुछ टेक्स्ट आपको हम बताएंगे जिसमें रिवर के डिस्ट्रक्टिव पोटेंशियल के बारे में काफी कुछ चर्चाएं हुई है। एक टेक्स्ट आपको बताएंगे, उसको असमिया में लिखा हुआ है नॉवेल, उसको इंग्लिश में ट्रांसलेट किया गया है, उसका नाम है चाइना टाउन डेज। उसी में आप देखेंगे ब्रह्मपुत्र में ट्रांसपोर्ट सिस्टम के बारे में दिया गया है, और ब्रह्मपुत्र का डिस्ट्रक्टिव पोटेंशियल के बारे में भी बहुत सारे चर्चाएं हुई है, और ब्रह्मपुत्र उसमें वीकनेस है, कितना ज्यादा सिविलाइजेशनल एक्चुअली हम लोगों ने हार्म किया है टू द रिवर और टू सिविलाइजेशन, एक वीकनेस के बारे में बताएं। और सुबीर अगर होंगे तो वो बताएंगे बंगाल में बहुत सारे नॉवेल्स आए दी है जिसमें बंगाल के रिवर्स के फ्लड पोटेंशियल और फ्लड हार्म और डैमेज के बारे में लिखा गया है। और हाँ, एक बात सच है कि when we talk about literature, we primarily talk about literature in a romantic vein. We try to defy literatures, but then I'm sure there are texts where we also look at the destructive potential of rivers.
मुझे लगता है कि
कम है, लेकिन है।
अधिकांश लोक साहित्य में नदियों की, खास तौर पर बिहार में और शायद ब्रह्म आसम में, मुझे लगता है कि वहाँ के लोक साहित्य में नदियों की जो विध्वंसात्मक भूमिका है उसके बारे में बहुत कुछ कहा गया। तो आप
नहीं, एक बात है कि क्योंकि हम लोगों ने उसी के बारे में चर्चा नहीं किया तो मैंने देखा नहीं अभी, लेकिन बहुत सारे है टेक्स्ट्स, नॉवेल्स भी है, पोएम्स भी है, टेक्स्ट है जिसमें रिवर के पोटेंशियल, डिस्ट्रक्टिव पोटेंशियल के बारे में लिखा गया है, लोक साहित्य में भी है और फॉर्मल लिटरेचर में भी है। लेकिन
थैंक यू।
अगला कोई प्रश्न इस प्रोफेसर दांता के?
बलराम जी
मैं प्लीज।
हाँ हाँ, रमाशंकर सिंह जी बोलना चाहते हैं, उसके बाद प्रोफेसर कालिदास मिश्र जी।
हाँ, अभी जो प्रोफेसर माधव हाड़ा कह रहे थे तो एक रामदास मिश्र का एक उपन्यास है पानी के प्राचीर, पानी के प्राचीर रामदास मिश्र के।
देखिए सर, मैंने पारंपरिक साहित्य पूछा है, मुझे लगता है कि आप कंटेम्परेरी आधुनिक साहित्य में तो बहुत जगह मिल जाएगा, लेकिन हमारे पारंपरिक साहित्य में कहाँ है ये चर्चा?
सापेक्ष रूप से नहीं है, लेकिन वो उसके विध्वंसात्मक रूप तो यत्र तत्र मिलते ही हैं। जलौघ का वर्णन, जलप्लावन आख्यान वेदों से मिलता है सबसे बड़ा जो है वो तो, लेकिन सापेक्ष रूप में साहित्य में कम मिलता है, तो बात सही।
एक उदाहरण मैं दक्षिण भारत से देना चाहता हूँ। कंबन जैसे जो कवि हैं, वो जब नदी के विध्वंसकारी रूप को वर्णन करते हैं उसको एक क्रिएटिव तरीके से पेश करते हैं, जैसे कि ये पुराने को धो के हटा रही है ताकि नया उसके जगह बन पाए। एक्चुअली उस विध्वंस को एक नए के सृजन के शुरुआत के रूप में भी पेश किया गया।
प्रोफेसर कालिदास मिश्र, आप कुछ पूछना चाह रहे थे?
दिस इज जस्ट एन ऑब्जर्वेशन, यू नो, ऑन प्रोफेसर दंतास पेपर। यू नो, आई वाज जस्ट गोइंग थ्रू दिस लाइन फ्रॉम श्वेता श्वेतर उपनिषद, यू नो, वेयर इट इज मेंशनड द वर्ल्ड इज द रिवर ऑफ गॉड, द वर्ल्ड इज द रिवर ऑफ गॉड फ्लोइंग फ्रॉम हिम एंड फ्लोइंग बैक टू हिम। Now, when we say flowing from him, you know, we understand. But when we say flowing back to him, वहाँ हम विलय की बात कर सकते हैं क्या? Can we talk of dissolution?
See, because you, thank you for this question, because you know the answer as much as I do. It's actually not necessarily about destruction. It's about the union of, you know, the individual soul with the supreme soul. So if we think of the river as flowing out of the supreme soul of the cosmos, then we think of, you know, our end not as the end but as a new beginning when we return to the cosmos. So I think I'll put it that way. Vinash ke bare mein to I don't know, if I have to look at the entire text then I'll be able to tell you, but then I think it will be presumptuous on my part to comment on that. But then I have a feeling that this is about returning to the cosmos, not about Vinash.
बिल्कुल सही बात है। यहाँ तक कि जल शब्द की जो व्युत्पत्ति दी गई है उपनिषदों में, ज का मतलब जिससे जन्म हो और ल का मतलब जिससे लीन हो, जिसमें लीन हो या हुआ जाए। यतो वायिमानि भूतानि जायन्ते येन जातानि जीवन्ति यत् प्रयन्त्यभि संविशन्ति उस्तत् जलानित्युपासित। इसलिए ब्रह्म का नाम भी जल ही है, तो कहीं ना कहीं
इन वेस्टर्न लिटरेचर आल्सो इट इज सीन एज बोथ लाइफ एंड डेथ। एंड इफ यू लुक एट ऑल रिचुअल्स इन इरेस्पेक्टिव ऑफ रिलीजंस, यू विल फाइंड birth is always associated with water and death is always associated with water. Doesn't really matter what religion, what cultural group, what geography we are from. So you can think of it as the ultimate return. Ya fir to koi symbolism ke bare mein hi soch le.
Any other questions on this paper? Teen comments Subrahmanyam sir ke hain, bade bade comments hain, to hum sab pad sakte hain isko. Iske अतिरिक्त अगला पत्र जो था वो डॉक्टर चांद बाशा का था और वो शरावती पर लिखे गए उपन्यास आइलैंड पर, द्वीप पर था। तो इस विषय में, इस पत्र से संबंधित हम चर्चाओं को शुरू करते हैं और उनसे किसी के प्रश्न हो तो आप
मैं प्लीज इंटरवेन सर
जी जी प्लीज
थैंक यू यू नो प्रोफेसर चांद फॉर योर प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन द नैरेटिव्स ऑफ डिस्पोजिशन यू नो विथ रिगार्ड टू ए पर्टिकुलर नॉवेल यू नो देयर यू यू नो मेंशन्ड वाल्टर बेंजामिन इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ डिस्पोजिंग द पीपल ऑफ देयर लाइवलीहुड And I believe that, and this is my, you know, suggestion, observation. Along with Benjamin, we can also think of another philosopher like, say, Martin Buber, you know, who wrote that celebrated essay, I, Thou, you know, or another essay by, say, Max Weber, where he is talking about this idea of instrumental reason. You know, I agree with what you have said, but this is just to add to your discourse. You know, Martin Buber, Max Weber, you know, have worked extensively to suggest how the modernity project failed, you know, in bringing in progress. And your novel is a classic example of that. So this is just a set of observation. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for kind, valuable suggestions. I'll definitely look into this text by Martin Buber and Max Weber to better understand the idea of ordinary displacement. Sure, sir.
Is shodh patra par koi aur charcha ya koi aur tippani koi aur prashn ho to uska swagat hai.
May I, sir?
Sure. Professor Arzuman Aral.
Actually, कल जो मेरा पेपर था उसमें नदिया के विध्वंस रूप के बारे में काफी चर्चा थी. समय की वजह से हम लोग ज्यादा चर्चा नहीं कर पाए. इसके बारे में असम में बहुत सारे लिटरेचर है, तो प्रोफेसर हाडा को मैं वही बताना चाहती थी.
धन्यवाद. Do we have Professor Subir Dhar with us? हम उनके पत्र पर चर्चा करें. पहले तो वो अपना अपना कथ्य पूरा करें, उसके बाद उसमें प्रोफेसर सुबीर धर इज हियर और नॉट.
आई डोंट थिंक सो. अभी तक तो ही सेज ही इज स्टिल गोइंग टू कनेक्ट. अभी तक आए नहीं.
कोई बात नहीं, तो अगले सेशन की ओर हम चलते हैं और मैं हैंड ओवर करता हूं हमारे बहुत ही सम्माननीय फेलो प्रोफेसर हितेंद्र पटेल जी को. वे अगले सत्र की अध्यक्षता करेंगे. ये सत्र बहुत ही विचार उत्तेजक पत्रों से पूर्ण परिपूर्ण रहा और अगले सेशन के लिए मैं प्रार्थना करता हूं सर से कि वे इसका संचालन भी करें और अध्यक्षता भी करें. धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू प्रोफेसर बलराम शुक्ल. द लास्ट सेशन गॉट इंटरप्टेड बिकॉज द लास्ट स्पीकर कुड नॉट कंप्लीट हिज प्रेजेंटेशन एंड आई वाज रियली इंटरेस्टेड इन प्रोफेसर सुबीर धर्स प्रेजेंटेशन. ही वाज माय एक्स कलीग. आई हैव वर्क्ड विद हिम एंड आई थॉट दैट where he actually would end his paper, because he has shifted his attention from imagination to power. So I wanted to get to know what he has to say on that. I don't know really what to do at this point of because as per the schedule, Professor Subir Dhar, Dr. Barik, and Dr. Chan Basha, who has given us a very interesting paper on, sorry, Arjuman Arai's, yeah.
जी सर, आपके सत्र में अभी दो लोग हैं, रमाकांत जी और डॉक्टर सावना बारिक. वो दोनों आपके सत्र में.
ओके ओके ओके. थैंक यू अर्जुमन.
रामशंकर जी भी इसमें इस सत्र में प्रस्तुत करेंगे.
यस. Before the session begins, let me say a few words following the model of Balaram Shukla ji. He gave some interesting observations on river and the importance of river in our literature, and he has given us something very interesting. I was preparing for a session on river in modern imagination, and I was really interested in knowing how scholars are responding to the question of the intricate and complicated relationship between creativity and civilizational issues. Yesterday, Professor Makarand Paranjpe brought in interesting insights into the whole question, and he emphasized the point of riverine civilizations, and he brought in some interesting issues. I am really interested to know, and all of us would be interested, what kind of relationship change has taken place about the imagination on rivers. When we think of poems, when we think of imaginations on rivers, we really get emotional. I was listening about the vidvanskari or destructive elements and all that. Poets are not really interested in those destructive things. And Madhav Hara raised this question, and poets are not supposed to do that. But still, modern writers are doing that. I'm really really interested in Arjuman Ara's interesting insight as the river as the repository of cultural memories, and she brought in very interesting insight into it. I would like to go further and say that repository of civilizational memory can also be part of it. And this is where there is a challenge, and that challenge has to be understood. And in that connection, when we think about creative outputs from at least Tagore to Hajarika, yesterday we had a very, very, very powerful and interesting paper on Hajarika by Dr. Boral. And all these things are coming into the play, and now scholars are thinking about role of river, thinking about river, and so on. In this session, we have Dr. Ramashankar Singh. I think he is one of the most promising thinkers on this subject. When I came here in Shimla, I could not think that a social scientist can deal with river in such a creative way as Ramashankar Singh has done. He has completed his work, and he had organized a remarkable conference on river and riverine communities. I still remember a few presentations of that seminar, which those presentations are still being debated and talked about on social media. You can understand what kind of impact it had. I understand that organizing this kind of a webinar like this is a very difficult job, and there are so many technical issues which could come in, and we don't have really any control over that. And Professor Subir Dhar, he would be around. I think after the presentation, two presentations which are supposed to take place in this session, after that, I would take the liberty of inviting Professor Subir Dhar to complete Patil sir,
this is Danta. Because he had, I think, about 5-6 minutes left from his paper. Unko kyun na hum kahe dein ki unka paper khatam kar diya jaye?
Oh, that would be great if that is possible.
I think he just came out for a while. Professor Subhidhar is here actually. We should request him to finish his paper. Agar possible hai to.
Yes, why not? I mean, I think that is quite possible. And in fact, I was interested in his paper. Because where he is going to end, that was also...
Subir, can you just actually finish your paper? Hello, Subir. I saw you for a while, if you're here.
Can you hear me? But
am I audible?
Yeah, sir, please.
Okay, how much time would you give me? 2 minutes or 3 minutes or 4 minutes?
3 minutes would be fine, but you can go up to four. This is Hitendra Patel.
Yes. Good to see you. Right. Let me quickly finish the last part of my paper once again.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
I said the relativity between power and the powerlessness of rivers, Tagore did not perceive in terms of a simple binary like subjection and dominance, but in terms of a product. The power of a mighty river like the Padma did not fill him with a humbling sense of the insignificance of human will, effort, or force. In an easy transition made from the observed reality of rivers to the metaphorization of these into a vital ontological awareness, he declared that life, quote, like a river, strikes its banks, them, but to realize anew every moment, opening towards the sea. It is as if a poem that strikes its meter at every step, not to be silenced by the expression every moment to the inner freedom of its harmony, unquote. The consciousness of this universal harmony led Tagore to inscribe his own understanding of the power of rivers. Drawing upon his readings of the Upanishads, Tagore claimed that there was a universal power which is manifested in the universal law, which is one with our own power. And he continued, it will thwart us when we are small, it will also help us where we are great, where we are in unison with the all, unquote. Tagore's language here of power and currents obviously draws upon a river symbolism full of potent sacerdotal undercurrents. It is possible to believe that his thinking was in line with the esoteric symbolism of Christianity, in which the two lines of the cross represent amplitude and exaltation respectively. This is translated into terms of the breadth of rivers and their forward movement towards the attainment of an oceanic metaphysical wisdom. That rivers were always held by Tagore to be expressive of a power different and superior to human social power. The social human social power, he said, can be measured in terms of a linear increase. As he put it, quote, it is the endeavor of those who hold power to be supreme, to increase in bulk. They would repeatedly multiply the numbers of coins, the number of appliances, unquote. The sad result of such unit by Tagore in his often less read treatise, Thought Relic, as a violence of the sacrifice of, quote, others' wealth, others', for sacrifice is the essence of the cult of power, unquote. Rivers were, in his imagination, somehow equivalent to the metonymic and metaphoric operations, roughly similar to diachronic and synchronic extensions. And so it is perhaps no accident that in a poem written in the afternoon of 23rd February 1941, barely 5 months before his death, he wrote, life of mine has been nurtured by rivers. In its heart, mountain peaks. Its fields have been formed by many alluvial layers. Vital juices from many sources have spread themselves in harvest upon harvests. From the east and the west, networks of song streams lull its sleep and wake. Brings the world near, carries the greetings of the unknown to my door. Unquote. Professor Patel, am I audible?
Yes, you were actually. As long as you spoke, you were audible, Rusubir.
You are audible.
I cannot see you, but we could hear you. Are you all right now? Are you okay? Are you still online?
Yeah, fairly okay. This connection is very problematic.
Yeah.
But, yeah, please go ahead and finish. Yes.
I have finished, as a matter of fact.
Okay. Okay. So, Patel sir, you finished.
Thank you, Professor Subidhar. If you would not have concluded somehow, it would have not been ideal. I think many of you would have some questions, but that would be taken up in Q&A session after the presentation of Dr. Rama Shankar Singh and another presenter. अब मैं डॉक्टर रमाशंकर सिंह जी से अनुरोध करूंगा कि वो हमारे इस सेशन में कुछ बोलें, और जैसा कि मैंने आपको कहा कि डॉक्टर रमाशंकर सिंह का काम बहुत ही अलग किस्म का है, और वो नदी और नदी के तट पर रहने वाली कम्युनिटीज़ के ऊपर एक बहुत ही अद्भुत किस्म का काम कर रहे हैं, जिसमें कि इतिहास बोल उठा है, और उस इतिहास में जो सामुदायिक स्मृति है, जो स्मृति हमारी अन्य स्मृतियों से भिन्न भी है और अपनी विशिष्टताओं को लिए हुए भी है, वो एक बहुत लंबे टाइम स्पैन को लेकर के चले हैं। और अभी जो निषादों के इर्द गिर्द जो बड़े आंदोलन सब हो रहे हैं, उसके बारे में भी उनकी चिंताएं हैं। नदी उनके लिए एक जीवंत विषय है, और नदी के किनारे बसने वाले लोगों की कहानियां, उनके इतिहास और उनके भविष्य की चिंता, इन तीनों को समेटते हुए डॉक्टर रमाशंकर सिंह ने एक बहुत शानदार काम किया है। मैं चाहूँगा कि नदी चर्चा में अपनी विशिष्ट वैदुष्य का लाभ हमारे अन्य साथियों को भी दें, और समय जैसा कि सबके लिए है 20 मिनट का समय हम लोगों के पास है, जिसमें उनकी जो मूल चिंताएं हैं उससे हम लोग परिचित हो पाते हैं, और उसके बाद अगर संभव हुआ तो कुछ प्रश्न हम लोगों के मन में जो होंगे वो उनके सामने रखे जाएंगे। डॉक्टर रमाशंकर सिंह ये हमारे यहाँ के फेलो थे अभी, और मैं उनका स्वागत भी करता हूँ, और डॉक्टर प्रोफेसर परांजपे को और अर्जुमन आरा को और बलराम जी को धन्यवाद देता हूँ। एक जो सबसे महत्वपूर्ण नाम मुझे लगा था इस कॉन्फ्रेंस में, जिनको होना ही चाहिए था, अर्जुमन वो नहीं आ पा रहे थे, लेकिन सौभाग्यवश ऐसा एक स्पेस बना और हम उनको इस विषय पर यहाँ सुन रहे हैं। डॉक्टर मासुकर,
मेरी आवाज आप सब लोगों को आ रही होगी, और जितना प्रोफेसर हितेंद्र पटेल सर ने मेरे बारे में कहा है, शायद मैं उतने के लायक नहीं हूँ, और ये उनकी उदारता है। और बड़े लोगों की और नदियों की ये सबसे अच्छी बात ये होती है कि वो उदार होते हैं, कोई उनको कुछ कहे या ना कहे वो उसके उसको उदारता पूर्वक देते रहते हैं, जैसे नदियाँ देती हैं। तो हितेंद्र सर का स्वभाव एक तरीके से नदी स्वभाव है मेरे लिए, अन्य लोगों के लिए भी, तो ये उनका बड़प्पन है। और संस्थान के कई लोगों से वर्चुअली जुड़कर ही मुझे बहुत अच्छा लग रहा है, और सारे जो विद्वतगण इससे जुड़े हुए हैं। कल शाम को बलराम जी ने इंडिकेट किया था कि शायद आपको कुछ बोलना पड़े, तो मैंने कल की जो पूरी प्रोसीडिंग्स थी और जो संस्थान के ट्विटर और फेसबुक अकाउंट पर शेयर की गई थी, तो उसको मैंने देर रात तक सुना, रिवाइंड करके कुछ बातें। तो इसका एक लाभ ये हुआ है कि मैं वही बातें नहीं बोलूँगा जिससे दोहराव का हो, मैं केवल यही कहूँगा कि बात जो लिटरेचर की हो रही है वह लोगों के जीवन में करता क्या है, कोई लिटरेचर लोगों के जीवन में क्या करता है। तो एक बढ़िया लिटरेचर, एक बलराम जी इसको अच्छे तरीके से बता सकते हैं कि भरत मुनि का नाट्यशास्त्र, संस्कृत के प्रोफेसर के जीवन को, या किसी जो ड्रामा कर रहा है उसके जीवन को, या जो प्रैक्टिसिंग अभिनेता अभिनेत्री है उसके जीवन को बदल सकता है, ऐसे बहुत सारे लेख। लेकिन जो उपन्यास, निबंध, लोकगीत रचे जाते हैं वह समुदायों के जीवन में क्या करते हैं, वह उनको कैसे बदल देते होंगे, तो मैं इस पे बात करूँगा। ये मेरे शिमला में मेरे शोध का विषय नहीं था, लेकिन उसको पढ़ते हुए मैंने पाया कि ये जो समुदायों की कल्चरल रिपोजिटरी है उसको सेव करने में लिटरेचर भूमिका अदा करता है, और ये दो तरीके से। एक तो आप सब लोग रामायण, महाभारत और जो लौकिक साहित्य है वह वेद, इस सब के बारे में जानते हैं, और उसमें खूब नदियों का वर्णन मिलता है। तो जब आप किसी भी निषाद से बात करेंगे भारत में, उत्तर भारत में स्थित, जब मैं यहाँ निषाद कह रहा हूँ तो यह एक जेनरिक टर्म है, उसमें कई जातियाँ आती हैं, बिंद, चाई, मल्ला, केवट, निषाद, बाथम, और इनकी संख्या बढ़ती जाती है जैसे जैसे आप गंगा के किनारे जाएं, सरयू के किनारे जाएं, छोटी छोटी नदियों के किनारे जाएं। आज या कल कोई कह रहा था कि केवल बड़ी नदियों का जो वृत्तांत है उस पर बात केंद्रित ना करके छोटी नदियों के वृत्तांतों पर भी बात केंद्रित की जाए, तो उस पर भी हम ये बात देख सकते हैं। तो वहाँ हमेशा इन सारे समुदाय में एक बात हमेशा ये आती है कि हमारा वर्णन वहाँ मिला है। जैसे हो सकता है कि कोई निषाद बहुत ज़्यादा प्रिंटेड सोसाइटी से ना ताल्लुक़ रखता हो, उसकी बहुत ज़्यादा शिक्षा दीक्षा ना हुई हो औपचारिक, लेकिन वह इस बात से बिल्कुल जाना पहचाना रहता है कि हमारा वर्णन जो है रामायण में है, हमारा वर्णन महाभारत में है, हमारा वर्णन रामचरितमानस में है, पद्माकर में है। और एक अभी हाल ही में मुझे एक निषाद वृद्ध मिले थे, तो उन्होंने बात बताई कि हमारा तो हमने ऐतरेय ब्राह्मण लिखा था हमारे पुरखों ने, ऐतरेय महिदास ने। तो मुझे थोड़ा झटका लगा कि मैंने इसे कभी पहले नहीं पढ़ा था। तो इधर फिर मैं जब कुबेरनाथ राय की निषाद बांसुरी पढ़ रहा था तो ये बात पता लगी कि हाँ, उनकी बातों में दम है। ऐसा माना जाता है कि जो ऐतरेय ब्राह्मण के रचयिता थे वह निषाद संतान थे। तो इस तरीके से ये जो समुदाय हैं, जो बिल्कुल कमज़ोर समुदाय हैं और बिल्कुल ख़त्म किए जाने के उस पर आ गए हैं, डिस्पोजिशन हो रहा है, उनकी नदियाँ उनसे छीनी जा रही हैं, उन्हें बालू नहीं निकालने दिया जा रहा है, नए नए कानून बनाए जा रहे हैं कॉलोनियल और पोस्ट कॉलोनियल स्टेट के द्वारा, इन दोनों के द्वारा जो कानून बनाए जा रहे हैं, जो का डिस्पोजिशन हो रहा है, उससे लड़ने के लिए वह इस सब का सहारा ले रहे हैं। एक बात तो ये होगी। अब दूसरी, मैं थोड़ा स्पेसिफिक आऊँगा कुबेरनाथ राय के बारे में, और कल भी बात हुई थी, आज भी बात हुई थी ब्रह्मपुत्र के बारे में, ब्रह्मपुत्र नदी के बारे में, और वहाँ के जिसे कहते हैं कल्चरल इकोलॉजिकल जियोग्राफी, उसकी जो संस्कृति है, उसमें जो गायक हैं, उसमें जो संगीतकार है, उन्होंने कैसे उनको कैसे ब्रह्मपुत्र ने रूप दिया। गंगा के बारे में भी यही सही है, यमुना या सरयू नदी के बारे में भी सही है। तो कुबेरनाथ राय का मामला यह है कि वो गाजीपुर में पैदा हुए थे और अंग्रेजी के वो प्रोफेसर हुए वहाँ नलबारी कॉलेज असम में, और ब्रह्मपुत्र ने उन्हें गंगा के बारे में पुनः पुनः सोचने के लिए बाध्य किया। ब्रह्मपुत्र ने वहाँ के लोगों की संस्कृति को किस तरीके से प्रभावित किया था, यह देखकर कुबेरनाथ राय ने गंगा की संस्कृति के बारे में बात करने की कोशिश की, और उससे ज़्यादा गंगा तीरी निषादों, यानी जो गंगा के किनारे निषाद बसे हुए थे, उनके बारे में उन्होंने सोचना शुरू किया। तो ये सबसे खास बात रही। और जब मैं अपना रिसर्च कर रहा था, और शुरू में ही लगा कि आप सब लोग जानते हैं कि जो लोगों का वर्ल्ड व्यू होता है, जो नज़रिया होता है, वो वहाँ की जो इकोलॉजी होती है, पारिस्थितिकी होती है, उससे प्रभावित होती है। शिमला के लोग जिस तरीके से सोचते हैं, निश्चित ही उसका वहाँ के पहाड़ों, वहाँ के देवदार, इवन बंदरों से, या वहाँ जो जानवर हैं, जो ढाल हैं, या जो बर्फ पड़ती है, उस सबसे शिमला या हिमाचल प्रदेश के लोगों का जीवन, उनकी संस्कृति और देखने का नज़रिया विकसित होता है, और विशेषकर रंगों के प्रति, सुबह शाम या पृथ्वी या वातावरण, सृष्टि, इस सब के बारे में उनका नज़रिया क्या है, इसके बारे में वह जो एनवायरनमेंट है वह उसको रूप देता है। और ये बात 1881 में थोड़ा औपचारिक तरीके से कल्चरल एंथ्रोपोलॉजी के जनक माने जाते हैं फ्रांक बोआस, तो उन्होंने नॉर्थ आर्कटिक सी के लोगों पर ये लगातार उन्होंने अपना अपनी नज़र बनाए रखी है। ऑब्जर्वेशन के द्वारा ये बताया कि यहाँ के लोगों का जो नज़रिया है वह जल प्रभावित करता है, यहाँ की जो बर्फ़ गिर रही है वह प्रभावित कर रही है, और ये खास तरीके की यहाँ भोजन की आदतें कैसे हैं वो यहाँ की जलवायु प्रभावित कर रही। तो कुबेरनाथ राय ने एक निबंध संग्रह लिखा 1882 में निषाद बांसुरी, तो निषाद बांसुरी में उनका एक निबंध है पाहन नौका। तो पाहन नौका में वो कहते हैं कुबेरनाथ राय, एक उसके जो नायक हैं, नायक क्या कह लीजिए जिनके बारे में लिखा जा रहा है, रंगा, तो रंगा के बारे में वो कहते हैं कि रंगा को पानी और मौसम के बारे में अद्भुत ज्ञान है। तो आप देखिए कि लगभग 100 सालों के अंतराल पर एक कल्चरल एंथ्रोपोलॉजिस्ट है और एक निबंधकार है जो हिंदी में लिख रहा है, और दोनों की बातें कैसे मिल रही हैं। और यह भी देखिए कि आर्कटिक सी में बसे हुए जो समुदाय हैं उनकी बातें किस तरीके के से पूर्वी उत्तर प्रदेश में जो गंगा के किनारे मिसार बसे हुए हैं उनकी आदतें और उनका जीवन के प्रति या नदी के प्रति जो नज़रिया कैसे मिल रहा है। तो ये बातें कुबेरनाथ राय समझाते हैं इसमें अपने निबंध में पाहन नौका में। लेकिन उनकी उनका जो सबसे मशहूर निबंध हुआ निषाद बांसुरी, इस निबंध की तीन खास बातें हैं। पहली खास बात यह है कि उन्होंने यात्रा की गंगा से पूरब की तरफ यानी आसाम की तरफ, और एक बातचीत की शैली में ये निबंध लिखा गया। दूसरा, न केवल उस जो चंदन उनका नाम है जो चला रहे हैं ना उनके बारे में बताता है, बल्कि उससे ज़्यादा यह कि वो नदी के बारे में क्या सोचते हैं यह बताता है। या इस तरीके का पहला प्रयास है कि जब एक समुदाय जो नदी में जिससे नदी की जीविका चलती है, जो रोज नाव चलाता है, उसका नदी से क्या रिश्ता नाता है वह ये बताती है। और अमूमन एक जो मुख्य धारा का नैरेटिव है उसमें तो हम ये कहते हैं कि नदियां हमारी माँ हैं, ये तो हम कहते हैं, लेकिन हम ये नहीं जान पाते कि नदियां हमारे बारे में क्या सोचती हैं। इस बारे में संस्कृत साहित्य जो मैंने पढ़ा उसमें बहुत कम वर्णन इस तरीके के मिलते होंगे कि जहाँ पर नदी अपने बेटों यानी जो नाव चलाते हैं उनके बारे में कम जानकारी मिलती है। तो उसके लिए ये एक लोक गीतों की तरफ जाते हैं कुबेरनाथ राय, और मैं उनका एक लोक गीत का अर्थ गा, उसका अर्थ ये है कि एक नाव लेकर जा रहा है एक नाविक, और उसकी नाव फंस गई है, और इसलिए वह नदी से प्रार्थना कर रहा है कि हे माँ मेरी नाव जो है इस नदी के बालू में फंस गई है और मुझे उबार लो। तो वहाँ पर वो उससे वंदना करता है कि मैं आपको एक पियरी धोती चढ़ाऊंगा, चुनरी चढ़ाऊंगा, और इसमें तो तुम्हारे लिए हार लदे हुए हैं, फूल जावा कुसुम के लदे हुए हैं, और मैं ये सब तुम्हारे लिए ही तो है। तो फिर नदी कहती है अपने अपने संबोधन में निषाद से कि वो निषाद जैसे मेरे जल को कोई काट कर दो टुकड़े नहीं कर सकते, वैसे ही तू भी अखंड अच्छेद है, और जब तक मैं हूँ, जब तक मेरी धारा है, तब तक तू भी वर्तमान है। अब ये एक तरीके से नदी निषाद को आशीर्वाद दे रही है। अब इसके बाद का जो मामला है वह कहीं ज़्यादा पॉलिटिकल हो जाता है। उसके बाद कुबेरनाथ राय लिखते हैं कि भारतीय धरती के आदि मालिक निषाद ही थे, भारतीय भाषाओं में मूल संज्ञाएं, भारतीय कृषि के मूल और आदिम तरीके और भारतीय मन के आदिम संस्कार इन्हीं की देन है। भोजन खान पान खेती बाड़ी हरबे हथियार सब निषादों की देन है। और सर्वप्रथम इसी गंगा की घाटी में धान चावल का आविष्कार किया गया, भैंसों को दुधारू बनाया गया, जड़ी बूटियों और फलों को पहचाना गया, खेती के औजारों को गढ़ा गया। तो और उन्होंने एक बात और ये बताई कि पूरी रामायण की कथा, अब वो महाकाव्यों पर आते हैं कि पूरी रामायण की कथा भले ही निषाद कल्पित ना हो, उसके ताने बाने में कुछ प्रसंग और विश्वास तो अवश्य ही है जो निषादों में प्रचलित रहे होंगे। अब जब ये बात उन्होंने 1980 के दशक में लिखी तो यह एक अंग्रेजी के एक प्रोफेसर का जो हिंदी में लिख रहा था उसका एक सामान्य डिलेबरेशन था। लेकिन इसी दौर में जब कुछ ही समय बाद 1989 के बाद जब मंडल कमीशन की रिपोर्ट लागू हुई और कई जातियों को ओबीसी जातियों में परिगणित किया गया तो उसने उत्तर भारत में निषादों को ओबीसी में रखा गया उत्तर प्रदेश के। तो जैसे ही ओबीसी में रखा गया निषादों के तो दो चीजें हुई, एक तो उन्होंने अपने गौरों के वृत्तांत खोजे, पहले से ही वो कर रहे थे, उनके बुद्धिजीवी थे, ग्राम्सियन टर्म में कहें तो उनके ऑर्गेनिक इंटेलेक्चुअल थे। तो उन्होंने रामायण महाभारत और पुराण इन सब में निषादों के संदर्भ खोजे, पहली बात तो ये हुई। दूसरी बात ये हुई कि गौरव के वृत्तांत की निषाद राजगुह का वर्णन किया गया, बताया गया कि महाभारत तो निषादों की रचना और गौरव के वृत्तांत ही किसी भी समुदाय को इकट्ठा करने में उतनी मदद नहीं करते जितना कि हिंसा और बहिष्करण के वृत्तांत। तो इसमें उनकी मदद की एकलव्य के नैरेटिव ने। उसी दौरान फूलन देवी की के चरित्र का उदय हुआ उत्तर प्रदेश में और जगह जगह गांवों तक में उनकी बारे में नौटंकियां खेली जाने लगी, पतली पतली चाय बुक्स आई। तो उस सब ने भी निषादों के भीतर एक गोलबंदी, एक सामाजिक गोलबंदी और बेहतर भविष्य के लिए एक सामाजिक चेतना का निर्माण। तीसरी बात ये हुई कि इस भारत भूमि का असली मालिक कौन है, इससे कोई सहमत हो या ना सहमत हो ये अलग बात है, लेकिन एक समुदाय इसको देखता कैसे है यह जानना ज़्यादा महत्वपूर्ण है। तो उस समय कुबेरनाथ राय के इस निबंध ने उनकी काफ़ी मदद की निषादों की और जो पतली पतली चाय बुक्स निषादों के द्वारा अपने पुरुषों, अपने सांस्कृतिक प्रतीकों, अपने जीवन दर्शन वर्ल्ड व्यू के बारे में लिखी गई, उसमें कुबेरनाथ राय की निषाद बांसुरी का जिक्र लगभग होता ही होता था और उसमें ये बात बताई गई कि ये जो मैं बता रहा था उनके थ्रू, कुबेरनाथ के राय के थ्रू, कि इस धरती के आदि मालिक निषाद ही। तो क्लेम करने की जो ताकत थी उसको इस निबंध ने, कुबेरनाथ राय के इस निबंध ने बढ़ा दी और इस तरीके से वह कहीं ज्यादा मोल भाव कर सके। और इसका सबसे बड़ा प्रमाण यह हुआ कि जब वह गंगा सहित पूर्वी भारत की छोटी छोटी नदियों पर अपना दावा पेश करने लगे कि नदी हमारी है और हम के बेटे हैं, नदी हमारी है और हम इसके बेटे हैं, तो उन्होंने इस तरीके के लिटरेचर की काफी मदद की। तो मैं केवल यही कहना चाह रहा था कि नदियों के बारे में जब हम सोचें तो उस तरीके के लिटरेचर को भी ध्यान में रखें कि जो किसी किताब से निकलकर किसी समुदाय के जीवन में शामिल हो जाता है और फिर उसे वह इमेंसिपेट करता है, उससे वह सबलीकृत करने लगता है। तो कुबेरनाथ राय का ये जो निबंध था निषाद बांसुरी, उसने निषादों की अस्मिता निर्माण में न केवल मदद की बल्कि जो उन्होंने अपने इतिहास लेखन की नई शुरुआतें की, सबाल्टर्न हिस्ट्री आप उसे कहें या ना कहें, तो उसमें उन्होंने मदद की। हितेंद्र जी बता रहे थे और अभिषेक भी इसमें जुड़े हैं, बलराम जी भी जुड़े हैं, तो आप सभी लोगों को स्मरण होगा कि वहाँ पर एक शिमला में जुलाई 2019 में आए थे वक्ता श्री लौटन राम निषाद जी। तो लौटन राम निषाद इस समय निषादों की राजनीतिक और सामाजिक गोलबंदी में लगे हुए हैं। तो उन्होंने कुबेरनाथ राय और ऐसे विद्वानों को खूब उद्धृत किया। तो मैं केवल ये कहना चाहता था कि ये जो नदी के इर्द गिर्द जो साहित्य उपजा और जिसमें निषादों का वर्णन किया गया, तो उसने उत्तर प्रदेश में अभी तक इस समय तक जब मैं बोल रहा हूँ तब उनको गोलबंद होने में काफ़ी मदद की है और उनकी सांस्कृतिक चेतना को पुनर्बलित करने में काफ़ी मदद की है। तो फील्ड में अगर आप जाएं तो इस तरीके के बहुत सारे नैरेटिव आपको मिलते हैं और दूसरी महाकाव्यों और जो कविताएं हैं जो उपन्यास हैं वह भी ऐसा नहीं है कि वो गांवों तक या निषाद समुदायों तक नहीं पहुंच रहे हैं, वह किन्हीं दूसरे तीसरे या चौथे माध्यमों से होते हुए वहां पहुंचते हैं और फिर वे समुदाय के जीवन में शामिल हो जाते हैं। मुझे लगता है कि मुझे इतनी ही बात कहनी थी। धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद डॉक्टर रमाशंकर जी, आपको उन सवालों की ओर जाने का मौका मिला जिन सवालों से नदी और नदी किनारे बसने वाले लोगों की सांस्कृतिक स्मृति का सीधा संबंध है। और मुझे लगता है कि इस कॉन्फ्रेंस में इस बात का एक जोड़ बनना चाहिए जो आपने इसमें जोड़ा है। मुझे बहुत खुशी है कि ये पक्ष इसमें जुड़ा। हम लोग इस बारे में थोड़ी चर्चा करेंगे, लेकिन हमारे एक और वक्ता हैं डॉक्टर शाओना बारिक, हु विल स्पीक ऑन अनकैनी इंडियन रिवर्स इन द ब्रिटिश माइंडसेट इन लेट 19th सेंचुरी इंडिया। आई थिंक डॉक्टर बारिक इज देयर।
यस सर, डॉक्टर बारिक इज ऑनलाइन।
या प्लीज Dr. Barik can present now. Unmute. I can't see Dr. Barik.
Can we log on to part 4? It's almost about to end this part.
Sorry?
Sir, can we log on to part 4? I think because this part
is... Okay, that will be fine. Okay. So,